with that, let me pass the microphone to Claire, and I hope you're going to have an enjoyable presentation. Thank you.
So hi everybody, so thanks a lot for this great opportunity to present my research. So today I'm going to talk about security design and household risk taking. And so it's a joint work with Laurent Calvet, Paolo Sodini and Boris Vallée. And so Laurent and Boris are here now. So this is what's great with the virtual seminars, co-authors can attend at no cost. So, so let's start with the motivation. So one of the major challenges of household finance is the low level of financial risk-taking by a relatively large share of the population. And so by not participating, these households forfeit an important source of income, which is a risk premium. And it might, in fact, reinforce wealth inequality. And it has also potentially large real effects, as household savings are directing towards safe assets, typically government bonds, instead of risky equity. And another potentially related challenge to the traditional economic theory is the rapid growth of the market for capital guarantee products over the last two decades. So capital guarantee products are products that are offering at the same time participation to the risk premium and a guarantee for the capital that is invested. And so today, capital guarantee products represent more than $4.5 trillion globally. And so these capital guarantee products take different forms. So we have like variable annuities in the US, wealth management products in China, or retail structured products. And so one challenge is that the rational choice portfolio theory cannot provide a clear economic rationale for the huge success of these products. So the questions we are addressing in this paper are the following. So first, does the capital protection that is embedded in these capital guarantee products affect household risk-taking? And if so, how? Are there or not any welfare benefits? And more generally, the question we address is, can security design affect household risk-taking by mitigating some behavioral biases? So I'm going to give you a preview of our results. So our paper is divided into two parts. So we first provide empirical evidence on the effect of capital guarantee products on household risk-taking. And so what we find is that capital guarantee products offer a positive share of the risk premium to investors, or a positive expected excess return. And what we also find is that households investing in these products increase their risk taking. The effect is even more pronounced for households that are ex ante less willing to take financial risk. Then we turn to the theory to try to understand a bit the empirical facts we observe. And so we develop a life cycle model. And so what we show is that in the presence of loss aversion with narrow framing or in the presence of pessimistic beliefs, the introduction of capital guarantee products lead to an increase in risk taking, which is in line to our empirical facts, and also sizable welfare gains. So maybe it's time to take questions. So I don't know if there are any questions at this stage. I'm very happy to answer them.
And we don't have any questions at the moment, but as soon as they appear, I'll let you know. Thank you.
Okay, great, thank you. Okay, so we contribute to the following strands of the literature. So first, we contribute to the literature on household financial risk-taking. And we also contribute to the literature trying to find ways to address this low financial risk-taking by a large share of the population. And so the different solutions that have been considered are improved financial literacy, financial advisors, or using default option. And so what we do in this paper is that we are considering how security design can also address this issue. Then our paper also relates to the literature on the costs and benefits of financial innovation and to the literature on how contract design can mitigate or cater to behavioral biases. So there is large economic literature looking at the design of contracts. And so what we do is that we look at the design of specific contracts, which are financial securities. And so my presentation will be divided into four parts. So first, I'm going to introduce you the design of capital guarantee products. And so I'm going also to show you how we price these products. And then I'll provide you with empirical evidence on the effect of risk-taking, the underlying mechanism and the implications for household welfare. So still no questions that...
No, we have questions. We have questions now. Great. So this downside insurance usually comes at a high cost. Are investors getting compensated for their risk exposure net of fees or premiums?
Yes. So so this is why exactly we do an asset pricing exercise. We want to measure exactly what is the expected excess return to investors. And so we do find in the market that we are considering that investors do benefit from this product in the sense that they get a significant share of the risk premium, even after taking into account the fees. Okay, so this is true in the market we are considering. That said, I think it's important to disentangle what comes from how these products are designed and whether or not households can benefit from these products. So in the market we are considering, households do get a significant share of the risk premium. It does not say that in other markets, fees might be much more excessive, which is a different question than whether or not these products can benefit households.
So could you explain how you measure risk taking of households? I assume you're coming to this question soon. So if you would like to answer it now, it's fine. If not, you can defer it later.
So yes, I'm going to describe to you how we measure risk taking. But basically, we measure risk taking at the product level, the share of the risk premium household get by investing in a product. And then the risk taking at the household level is weighted average of this risk taking index across the products they're investing in. So basically, what share of the risk premium they get by investing in different products.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so let me talk about the market for capital guarantee products we are considering. So we are looking at Sweden from 2000 to 2007. And so the reason why we focus on Sweden is that we have very detailed information both on capital guarantee products and on household portfolio decisions. And so in 2002, banks started introducing capital guarantee products in Sweden. And at the same time, for each household, we can observe many detailed information on their demographics, but also on their portfolio composition. So we have the ISIN code of each product each household is investing in. And we also have a database of all the capital guarantee products that have been sold in Europe during the period. And so we can merge with the ISIN code. And so we have, which gives us, the detailed information about these capital guarantee products, such as the underlying assets, the exact design, and this is what we're going to use to to compute the markup and the expected excess return for each of these products. And we also have detailed information on all the equity mutual funds that has been sold in Sweden during the period. And so this very rich set of data will allow us to investigate what is the effect of the introduction of capital guarantee products on household risk taking. Is there any question about?
Not question at the moment. Let's move on probably and see. Okay. Oh, could you compare the increase in CGP flows to flows in overall equities over the same time frame?
Like, can we observe like the introduction of other equity products? I'm not sure about the question.
I guess probably the question relates to how much more did this, you know, how much money went to the CGP products relative to the, you know, net increase in the flows to the equity products over this time period?
Yeah, so what we observe is that within 5 years, these products have reached 14% of Swedish households, which is a large share of Swedish households. And those who did participate to capital guarantee products, they have invested 11% of their financial wealth in these products. So this is also one of the reasons why we were interested in this product in this country in this specific period of time, is that these products have been very successful and adopted very quickly by Swedish households. And so in Sweden, capital guaranteed products are defined in the following way. So they have an underlying asset. So usually it's a stock or an index. These products have a fixed maturity of 4 to 5 years and a non-linear payoff formula that includes a guarantee. And also, the final return is measured using the average performance of the underlying asset over a time period. And so, of course, the first question is whether or not households do get a share of the risk premium when they invest in these products. And so to answer this question, we do an asset pricing exercise. And so the objective is to measure the expected excess return households get when they invest in this product. So we obtain this expected excess return by doing Monte Carlo simulations. And so we make the assumption that the underlying asset follow a geometric Brownian motion. And so we estimate, so for each underlying, we estimate mu in a CAPM model and we use the historical volatility. And so what we observe is that the expected excess return is 2.6% on average for capital guarantee products. So it's lower than for equity funds. For equity funds, it's 3.3% on average, which is not surprising because of the guarantee, but it's not that much lower. Is there any question about how we measure the expected excess return?
No, but there is a question about, yeah. Do you see the wealth that households can have in the pension funds? So to what extent do you see the full picture of their financial assets?
So in the beginning of the 2000 in Sweden, the pension system is mostly social security pension system. And they just started pension funds in the mid-2000. So unfortunately, this is not something we observe. But we know that the amount of money invested in this pension fund is very low during this period.
Okay, thank you.
And then in a second step, we measure the markup of the capital guarantee products. And so we define the markup as the difference between the price investor pay and the fair value of these products in a Black and Scholes framework. And so when we compute this fair value, we take into account all the features of the contract, like the capital guarantee, the participation rate, the Asian option, the fact that these products don't pay dividend, and so on. And so the market is therefore a complete measure of the profit earned by the bank. And so what we find is that the markups are relatively high, 1.6% on average, but very comparable in magnitude to the markup the banks are earning with equity mutual funds. So in Sweden, during the period, average yearly fees on equity mutual funds are 2.4%. So we are in a country where investing in equity products is costly for investors, and it's not more costly to invest through capital guarantee products than to invest through equity mutual funds.
Okay, here we have a couple of questions related to the measurement, I believe. So is capital guarantee product a substitute for bank deposit?
So no, we don't, we observe an increase in, so what we observe is that we do observe an increase in risk taking for households, which means that when they invest in capital guarantee products, they mostly take money from bank deposits. And we find another interesting result that I'm going to show you after, showing that there is similarity in how people invest in capital guarantee products with how they deposit money in their bank accounts. So what we find is that there is indeed evidence that that these products are working as a kind of substitute for deposits. And so that's why we have like this increase in risk taking.
If a more realistic process for the underlying with fat tails is used instead of GBM, how this would affect expected return estimates?
So if we are using like fat tails, we might in fact so the value of a call option is higher when volatility is higher. So we might be overestimating markup with the model we are using now compared to if we were using like fat tails, for example.
Okay, when calculating the excess return on the capital guarantee products, do you also take into the consideration the risk of the guarantee offered by the bank?
Yes, we do. So we do take into account the credit risk of the bank. So that's an important question. We definitely take it into account. It's important to have in mind that in the beginning of the 2000s, this credit risk is very low. Okay, so we use default spread on debt issued by banks, and this credit risk is very low. But yes, we do take it into account.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's switch to the empirical evidence on the effect of these capital guarantee products on household risk taking. Okay, so the first step is how to measure household risk taking. So I've already talked a bit about this. And so first we measure risk taking at the product level. And so the way we measure it is that we look at the fraction of the risk premium that the product offers to investors. And so for each product, we define eta P as a ratio of the expected excess return over the market risk premium. And so this risk-taking index at the product level, so this risk-taking measure is on average 44% for capital guarantee products and 55% for equity funds. So because of the guarantee, it's lower for capital guarantee products, but again, it's not that much lower because we find that the markup is lower than for equity funds. And what we also observe is that the beta of equity fund underlying is below one. So that also explains why this risk-taking index is only 55% for equity funds. And then how do we measure risk-taking at the household level? We take the weighted average of these risk-taking measures at the product level across the different products the household is investing in. And so the objective of this measure is to take into account the fees of each product, the exact design, and also the beta. And so usually what the literature uses is simply like the share of financial wealth invested in equity products. And so we think this measure dominates the traditional measure because we do take into account the fees, the design, and also the beta of the underlying assets.
Okay, a couple of questions here. How often the CGP price is updated? I see that the yearly markup can be negative.
So what do you mean by how often the
How often prices of these capital guarantee products are updated?
So the products are issued once, and then investors, they do keep this product for a length of 4 years, and usually they don't exit the product. So these products are not traded, the products we're looking at.
Okay. Do these products on average guarantee 100% of capital or a lower percentage? Or there is a menu of offering products at different strike prices?
So they do. So these products in the markets we are looking at, they guarantee 100% of the capital, but you have to pay an initial fee to invest in these products, which means that if you pay on average initial fee is around 10%, which means that in practice it's 90% of the capital that is guaranteed. And so there is not much variation in the design of these products in Sweden. So that's why we've been able to run our asset pricing exercise. So more than 50% of the products have exactly the same type of design. So they have values underlying, but they have this type of design where you have the guarantee, you pay an initial fee to invest in the product, and you invest for a length of 4 to 5 years.
Okay, thank you.
And so then what we do is that we compare the risk taking index in 2002 and 2007 for households that did participate in capital guarantee products and households that did not participate in capital guarantee products. And so what you see in black are households that did participate at least once during the period in capital guarantee products. And so what you see is that there is a gap in the risk-taking index for between participant and non-participant in 2007. So this is the result for the full sample. Then what we do is that we focus on a subsample of the population, which is a household in the bottom quartile of risk-taking in 2002. So ex ante in 2002, these households have a very low risk-taking index. And then we look at their risk-taking index in 2007. And so what we see is that it has increased much more for households who did participate in capital guarantee products. And this gap in 2007 between participants and non-participants is much higher when we focus on this share of the population than on the full sample of the population. So we have preliminary evidence that the introduction of capital guarantee products increase risk taking for households that are ex-ante less willing to take risks. Okay, so then we run regression to confirm this result. And so we start with a simple diff-in-diff specification. And so we regress the change in the risk-taking index over the period, so from 2002 to 2007, on a basis that indicates whether or not the household has invested in capital guarantee products. And so we can control for a very large set of characteristics. So this is one of the great advantages of this data. So we include deciles of financial wealth, income, the risk-taking quartiles of the risk-taking index ex-ante, years of education, age, number of children, gender, and even like we even have like province and fixed effects. And so what we observe is that the risk-taking index, the percentage change in the risk-taking index is 24 percentage points higher for households who did participate to capital guarantee products. And so we look at total risk-taking, but also at active risk-taking. So we want to make sure that the effect is not driven by market returns. So what we do is that we measure a market neutral risk-taking index, which is in fact where we in fact neutralize the effect of stock market performance. So this market neutral risk-taking index only take into account the active changes in risk-taking. So the decision, the household decision to buy or to sell financial products. And so when we look at the active change in risk-taking, we do observe also that there is an increase, like the increase is higher for participants in capital guarantee products.
All right, here we have some questions. Unfortunately or fortunately, Laurent has been answering most of them, so I only have one to ask at this moment. How do you know the causation doesn't run the other way? Capital guarantee products could be introduced because more people are willing to take greater risks. Given the boom from 2002 to 2007, people might have become less risk averse.
So what's not clear is why you would need like capital guarantee products instead of equity funds. So I don't see exactly like the reverse causality. So so what we cannot like what we should observe in this case is an increase also in investment in equity fund, and it's not clear why. So if these people are becoming less willing to take risk, it's not clear why banks should be offering products with a capital guarantee. And then also to solve possible endogeneity issues, we're going to run an IV. So this should also address this issue.
Do you see an increase in the uptake of equity funds as well?
That's a good question. So over the period, we do not find any increase in the risk-taking. So if we look at the risk-taking index in aggregate, it does not increase over the period on average for households. That's even a bit the opposite. So it's as if households were rebalancing their portfolio as stock markets were doing better.
If you were to have access to the data after the Great Recession, is it likely that demand for these products dropped significantly?
So we would expect a bit the opposite. So after the financial crisis, so because you have a capital protection, so the possible risk of loss is more salient. So we would expect more demand for these products. And so in fact, what we know is that we do observe global data on these products, and the volumes have been increasing over the years. So products with a capital guarantee are taking different forms. And so, for example, wealth management products with a guarantee in China have been increasing a lot. And so today, the total market of products with a capital guarantee is close to $5 trillion globally.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, then we look at how the effect vary along households' willingness to take risks. Okay, so what we do, so we measure the willingness to take risks ex ante by filtering out household characteristics from the initial risk-taking index. And then we regress the household change in the risk-taking index over the period on the variable indicating whether or not households have participated in capital guarantee products. And we interact this dummy with the risk-taking index ex ante. And so we arrive at this graph. And so what we see is that the effect of capital guarantee products is much higher for households with ex ante a low risk-taking index. And so the vertical dotted line shows the median risk-taking index in 2002. And so you see that the lower the risk-taking index ex ante, the higher the effect of participating in capital guarantee products. And so if we just focus, like, for example, on the bottom quartile of the population in terms of risk-taking index, the effect is close to, is on average, like 50%, a 50% increase in the risk-taking index. And then we want to investigate a bit more the mechanism. And so this is going to answer the question of whether or not these products are kind of substitute with bank accounts. So what we do is that we look at the share of financial wealth invested in different products as a function of a household willingness to take risk. And so we look at whether the pattern for capital guaranteed products is very different from the pattern for other equity products. And so this is the result. And so what you see is that the patterns are very similar for capital guaranteed products as for bank deposits. So the share of financial wealth invested in capital guaranteed products is decreasing with the risk-taking index, exactly as bank deposits. Why, in fact, it's increasing for equity funds and stocks. So it suggests that indeed, capital guarantee, the way people invest in capital guarantee products is similar to the way people invest in bank deposits.
Okay, here's some question. Did these assets decrease income inequality in regions that were used more? Do you recommend the use of such products against income inequality in general rather than government transfers?
So yes, so that's one of the important, interesting implications potentially of our results. So yes, we do think that by offering these products, you can make a significant share of the population participate more in stock markets as soon as, of course, these products are marketed in a reasonable way. Okay, if there is not too much rent extraction from the banks. So whether it's going to solve all the issue of wealth inequality, this is another question. But we do think that it can improve people access to the equity premium. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so then what we do is that we run an IV. So the objective is to solve the possible endogeny issue, which can be downward. We could have a downward or upward bias in our OLS estimation. And so what we do is that we estimate a panel model where we regress the risk-taking index of the household on the share invested in capital guarantee products. And so this is a panel model with a household on year fixed effect. And so what we want is to instrument the share invested in capital guarantee products. And so we instrument it using time varying shocks to the supply of capital guarantee products from the bank with which the household has the strongest relationship. So here we are not using the matching of household with banks because we have household fixed effect. We are using the time variation in the supply of the product by banks. So our specification is immune to the possible issues resulting from the endogenous matching between household and banks. Again, what we are using is the time variation in the supply of these products by banks. And so how do we measure a bank idiosyncratic supply? So we are using the volumes sold to households, and we filter out demand effect using our very large sample of household characteristics. And we estimate this idiosyncratic supply shock on a subshare of the population. And then we run the IV on another share of the population. And now I'm just showing you a graph that motivates our identification strategy. So we are measuring this idiosyncratic supply shock because we do observe that the volumes sold by banks are largely driven by supply effects. And so it might be due to the possible marketing strategy or to the access to structuring desks, because you need also to have access to the technology to structure these products. And so just to illustrate, this graph plots these graphs plot the volumes sold by the main four Swedish banks in Sweden and abroad of these products. And so what you see is that there is a strong correlation in the amount that is sold domestically or abroad by the same bank. So which is very consistent with the fact that it's more driven by supply than by demand. What we do also is that what we find also is that in a panel analysis, we find that the within bank correlation on the supply of products across countries is much larger than the within country supply of this volume sold of these products. Okay, so there is a very strong within bank correlation, which is much larger than the within country correlation in the volume sold.
Okay, a couple of questions here. Yeah. So, do you observe that there is any evidence that these products have been targeted towards some particular households? So, for example, they are more promoted in the areas with presumably lower financial sophistication of households, I mean, for example, rural areas.
Yeah, so one question is, to which extent this market is predatory and is like addressing people that are less sophisticated? So we do, so what's good is that with our data, for example, we can observe IQ. And so we do not observe that banks are selling products, these products mostly to people with a lower IQ. And most importantly, we do not observe that banks, that markups are higher when these products are sold to people with a lower IQ, and that's even almost, it's not significant, but that's almost even the opposite. And so we, yes, so we do not like find evidence consistent with a predatory view of the markets where banks would mostly sell these products to less sophisticated households.
It's interesting that these products are in demand only for the most risk-averse households. One would have expected some response from moderately risk-averse households as well. Do you have some feel for why that is?
So there is. So what's important is that there is some demand for these products from all types of households. Okay, so we do find that all types of households are investing in these products. The big difference in the propensity to take risks. So it does change the risk taking only of households that are less willing to take risk ex ante. And so, but why is it the case? So that's an interesting question. And so that's why in the second part of the paper, we develop a theoretical model exactly for this. We want to understand why we have an effect on household risk taking only for households that are ex ante less willing to take risks. So this is what I'm going to answer in the theoretical part of the discussion of the paper.
Thank you.
Okay, so these are the results of our IV analysis. So the first column shows the coefficient in a basic OLS model. And so what we find is that when the share of financial wealth invested in capital guarantee products increase, the risk-taking index also increases. And so if household would invest only cash in these products, then the coefficient should be equal to the risk-taking index of these products, so 0.44. What we observe is that it's 0.21, which suggests that to invest in these products, household use half cash and half money from a standard equity funds. And then the second column shows the first stage of our IV. And so we do find that these idiosyncratic supply shock have an effect on the share invested in capital guarantee products. And the F statistics is more than 500. And then when we run the second stage, we do confirm that investing in capital guarantee products has a positive effect on household risk-taking index. We also observe that the effect is larger for households that are less willing to take risk ex ante. Okay, so now let's talk about the underlying mechanism. So now we want to understand why capital guarantee products have a positive effect on household risk-taking. And ideally, we would like also to measure what are the possible welfare benefits. And so to answer this question, we develop a life cycle model of portfolio allocation. And so ideally, we want to match the model with the following three empirical facts. So we want to observe a demand for capital guarantee products. We want to observe an increase in risk taking associated with the introduction of these products. And a larger effect on households that are ex-ante less willing to take risks. And then once we have developed a model that matches these empirical findings, we'll be able to measure the possible welfare gains associated with the introduction of capital guarantee products. So we start from the life cycle framework of Coco, Gomez, and Manhout. And so the agent faces a mortality risk and a labor income risk. And so if you remember the standard model, the agent can invest in a riskless asset and a risky asset. So in our setup, it will be a standard equity mutual fund. And the agent has a recursive utility over consumption streams. So the utility depends on consumption today and the certainty equivalent of future consumption. So what we do is that we augment this model by introducing a capital guarantee product. And so we use the design of the baseline product in our data. And we model exactly the design, the fees, and also the illiquidity aspect of these products. So if you remember, these products have a fixed maturity of 4 years. And so households have access to funds only after these 4 years. And then once we have built this life cycle model, what we can do is that we can span different utility functions and different beliefs and see what utility function and what set of beliefs can explain the three main empirical facts we obtain from the data. So is there any question about this setting?
I'm not seeing any, but as soon as I have them, I will give them to you. Thank you.
So we start first with the Nebstein-Gene utility function. And we solve the model numerically for the baseline capital guarantee products and the median household. And so the idea is to see whether or not the neoclassical framework works. And in fact, we find that we can reject the neoclassical framework. The introduction of capital guarantee products with a standard Nebstein-Gene utility function has no effect on risk-taking. Okay, so the reason is that the benefit of the guarantee is not large enough to compensate for the loss of the risk premium. So it does not change the risk-taking behavior of households. So then we consider other set of utility function. And so we've tried loss aversion, narrow framing, but what we find is that we need loss aversion with narrow framing to arrive at the empirical facts we described. So here we use the Barberis and Wong utility function. And so we have a loss aversion in the sense that if the financial wealth goes below a reference point, there is a negative effect on a household utility, which is nonlinear. So the lambda is there to represent the nonlinearity of the effect. And there is some narrow framing in the sense that what matters for household is not total wealth, but the household considers separately the financial wealth and the potential losses in financial wealth. And so then when we have a utility function with both narrow framing and loss aversion, we do observe an increase in risk taking. And we observe that this effect is larger for households that are ex-ante less willing to take risks. So basically, the effect is larger for households that have a higher lambda. So the lambda being the kink in the utility function. Is there any?
Do you see households borrowing against these products? If so, would you know where they invest in the borrowed funds?
So can they use this product as collateral to borrow money?
I guess that's a question.
Yeah, I'm not sure this is possible. So at least in Europe, it's almost impossible to borrow against the equity portfolio.
Okay, thank you.
And so this is a life cycle model. So what we can do is that we can plot the portfolio of households over their lives. And so you see the amount invested in capital guarantee products, stocks and liquid assets in the graph in the left-hand side. And so you see that there is a significant amount invested in capital guarantee products and that it's increasing until the age of more or less 70 or 65. And so the total amount of savings is then decreasing because the household has retired. And then we look at the change in risk-taking as a function of the risk-taking index ex ante. And so we find that the effect is this, the introduction of capital guarantee products leads to an increase in risk-taking for households with a low risk-taking index ex ante. So then we also consider the effect of pessimistic beliefs. So we are considering the fact that the agent might also have subjective beliefs over the payoff distribution of the asset. And basically, there would be a transformation in the density function of the payoff distribution, putting potentially more weight on negative outcomes. And so we do find that pessimistic beliefs can also rationalize all the increase in risk-taking and the heterogeneity of the effect. So these two graphs plot what we obtain when we use a Prelec density transformation. So we do observe an investment in capital guarantee products, and we do observe a change in risk-taking, which is higher for households that are less willing to take risks. And so we also find that we can match our empirical results when we use a high probability of crash risk or volatility misperception, which means that when people overestimate the probability of crash risk, then you can have demand for these products, or you can or when you have volatility misperception. And so you have demand, most importantly, you have a change in risk taking when you introduce this product. When you have these pessimistic beliefs.
Okay. So here's the question. Is it possible that CGPs fill a gap in the menu of risk return products? They seem to be slightly more risky than bank deposits, but less in equity. This would mean you observe increase in risk taking, but no change in risk aversion.
Yes, so we think it comes from a change in risk taking because indeed these products are completing market for these households with a lower willingness to take risk. So we do not think that it's a change in preferences. We do think that these products are catering to some specific behavioral biases.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so then we look at the implication for household welfare. So the increase in household risk-taking translates into higher consumption and utility. So with our life cycle model, we can plot consumption for before and after the introduction of capital guarantee products. We plot the change in consumption for households that are in the bottom quartile of risk taking index ex ante. And then we look at the change in utility across risk taking index ex ante. And so we look first at the decision utility. So we are assuming that we measure household welfare, or we are assuming that the decision of the household is based on a utility, which is the same as the way a household is experiencing consumption. So we assume that the decision utility is the same as the experience utility here. And we observe an increase in the decision utility, which is consistent with the fact that there is demand for this product. So there is demand for this product because it increases the decision utility of households. So now we want to measure exactly welfare gains. And so the way we measure it is that we look at what should be the wealth transfer at the beginning of the life of a household to be equivalent to the effect of the introduction of these capital guarantee products on consumption, to have the same effect on consumption. And so we assume that stock return and the riskless rate are the same before and after innovation. And then once we have measured this wealth transfer, we can also measure profit for the banks. And so we look at how the surplus is shared between household and the bank. And so we do so for our two main models. So the model of loss aversion with narrow framing, so Barbaris and Wang, and also with pessimistic beliefs. And so we observe a substantial gain in utility that would be equivalent to giving $15,000 at the beginning of the life of a household, on average, more or less, for both of the models. And so when we measure also the profits of the bank, what we find is that in our setting, households get close to 50% of the surplus. Okay, so one question is how exactly do households experience the benefits of these products? So the idea is that people can make decisions with a specific utility function, but then when they experience consumption, their utility function is a bit different. And so here we are making the assumption that households experience their consumption with a standard CRRA utility function. And so we want to see that even if we consider that there is loss aversion only in the decision utility, households still benefit or not from these products. So this is a very conservative view where households in fact have biases only when they make decisions and not when they experience their consumption. And even when we take this very conservative setting, we do observe that the introduction of capital guarantee products increase the utility of households that are less willing to take risk ex ante. So what you see is that this is not the case for households that are more willing to take risk ex ante. And so the reason might be that people that are willing to take risk ex ante are over-investing in these products, substituting them from equity funds. And at the end, they might experience a lower utility because they benefit less from the equity premium. But we still find a very strong positive effect for households that are ex ante less willing to take risk. Okay, so now I'm going to conclude. So this paper provides both empirical and theoretical evidence that innovative security designs, such as contracts with capital protection, can foster household risk-taking by mitigating behavioral biases. And so introducing such products can lead to a welfare gain, particularly pronounced for households that are initially less willing to take risks. And so this result illustrates a bright side to the interaction of behavioral biases and security design. And it has possible direct policy implications if we think about how to make people participate more to stock market and benefit more from the equity premium, or how to allocate more funds to the funding of the economy. Okay, so thank you. I don't know if you have any additional questions.
Well, you see, your co-authors have been very busy answering all the questions, so I guess it's kind of contributed to this presentation running a bit short regarding our allocated time. So I have a couple of questions that I can think and still read. Well, first of all, it seems like this product is really in demand for people who are overall scared to invest in equity-like products. So can you estimate, at least, it would be interesting to estimate what is the size of this market, well, let's say for the American, for other economies, for example, because this type of financial products seem to be primarily introduced in Europe. So, and yet at the same time, in the United States, we have a lot of low-income people unwilling to invest in the stock market because of, loss aversion, things like this. So for different wealth points in the wealth distribution, could you estimate, for example, how much demand for this product could there be, and demand for this type of financial innovation for other markets?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So in fact, what we do, we want to know, like to answer your question, we would like to know to which extent Sweden is representative to other countries in terms of initial risk-taking. And so we do find that, in fact, Sweden is very close to the US. Okay, so which means that the risk, the share of households that do participate in stock markets is very similar, so close to 50%. And once we consider these households, the median share of financial wealth invested in equity products is also very similar, around 40%. And so in theory, we could assume that there would be the same demand for these products in the US as in Sweden, which is consistent with the fact that we do observe some products with a capital guarantee in the US, for example, with annuities, structured annuities offering a kind of guarantee in annuities, or also we do observe some certificate of deposit with a guarantee.
Can you explain what behavioral biases prevent risk taking? Why is it not that CGPs provide a product that matches the risk preferences of a subset of investors where no product existed before?
Okay, so the behavioral biases we have in mind again are either pessimistic belief or loss aversion with narrow framing. And then why these products were not offered before? So you need a technology to be able to offer these products. So the banks need to be able to hedge to offer the capital protection. So these products starting to be offered in the beginning of the 90s, and then banks started discovering that there was some demand from. So initially they were offering this product to institutional investors in the 90s, and they realized that there was a strong demand for these products from retail investors, and so this is why they started offering this product in the 2000s. Then why the market has not developed before in the US, it's because of regulatory reasons. So before, you could not buy these products if you did not have a financial wealth above $1 million. And banks then have found ways to offer different products where every household can invest in. So it's partly because of the technology and partly because of the regulation.
Okay, I think we are done with the questions at this moment. So thank you very much for the wonderful presentation. I want to remind our participants that today you have the opportunity to hang out with Claire and co-authors after the presentation. So let's take another, again, 10 minutes break. And for those of you who would like to ask some additional questions or about with respect to this paper or, the broader research agenda of Claire and Boris and Laurent, you're happy to stay and ask questions in informal way. But for now, thank you very much again for attending our seminar. Thank you for presentation And we hope to see you next week. Next week we have Ludo Falipu from Oxford, who is going to talk about the private equity returns. Thank you very much and see you next week.